The Zone Coverage Podcast Network.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to the Minnesota Soccer Podcast. The season is over. We have survived, and Minnesota United had yet another record-breaking season in MLS. And as we dig into that, I am, as usual, joined in Minneapolis by Nick Hallett and Tom Schreier. Gentlemen, how you doing tonight?
Can't complain.
I'm good, bro. I'm real good.
You feeling full?
No.
Okay.
You know that. You saw me not finish my burrito.
It's true. We got half of it right there.
That was like the one mean thing you could say to me. Harsh.
Well, I get to enjoy this podcast knowing that Nick's got half a burrito sitting in front of him that he can't touch until we're done.
It smells great, too.
So I'm going to drag stuff out as long as we can. So if we go an hour and a half, listeners, that's why, is because I just want to make Nick suffer a little bit more.
I think the listeners appreciate and encourage that action.
I'm just going to go to one word answers.
Yeah, I would hope
so. How would you describe the Minnesota United season as a whole? Yes.
That's my entire opinion. The one word summary. Yes.
That's the opposite of a filibuster.
By the way, let's dig into this. So last game of the season on Sunday, we are recording on Monday night as a result of the Sunday night game and Mr. Hallett having to attend the Vikes getting their butts whooped.
That's true. I was at US Bank Stadium.
More on that later. So Minnesota United were one of the last two teams in the last game of the MLS regular season to finish as a result of a weather delay in Columbus as a result of lightning storm that passed through the area. And it seemed like conditions in this game were not particularly conducive to playing soccer in that it was crazy windy, at least for the first half of the game. It was commented on less by the Fox Sports North team in the second half, but in the first half in particular, it was like 30 mile an hour winds, rain, slick pitch, just messy, messy game. And it finished 3-2 to Columbus, which Columbus needed a win going into the game. But by halftime of the game, the result in New England had finished. Montreal lost to New England, which eliminated them from the playoffs and confirmed Columbus in the playoffs. They came on over the PA announcer in the stadium and announced that. So I assumed that the second half of this game was just going to be awful to watch since the first half wasn't great. But it was actually very fun to watch. Four goals, good play by both sides. Gentlemen, I know you both saw at least parts of this game. Nick, what drew your eye in what you saw?
Well, I mean, I think it's really clear take one of the main takeaways from a Minnesota United perspective, and that's that Francisco Calvo clearly needs to only play defense for the rest of eternity. Like, I don't know why you'd ever play that guy forward. I don't know why you'd ever allow him to get forward. That guy needs to be a center back only. I mean, maybe we should even think about playing him at goalie just to keep him, you know, on that side of the field, because clearly he's not useful going forward. I mean, that is clear. And I mean, so there's a lot of Heath detractors, and you have to point out, like, Calvo's resurgence as an outside back and clearly what he can offer going forward and whenever on the ball in general. I mean, that's one of the strikes you could almost start to put against Heath right now, because I don't know how Heath sees that ability, sees that squad depth that is clearly lacking, and he hasn't. It's taken this long to get Calvo further forward.
So the strange thing for me is, I remember, I think it was the first game that United played four at the back with Calvo at left back, It was a home game, and I remember the media talked to Calvo after the game, and I may have misunderstood his point. He may have not made his point as clearly as he wanted to, but it seemed like from his comments that he wants to play center back and that he'd rather play center back than play on the outside or play wherever else on the pitch you'd want him. So I get that there's a bit of Heath criticism there, but I would love to know from Francisco Calvo, like, because he really seems to both be very skilled at and enjoy attacking. Like, what?
See,
where does he want to be? Where does he think his best position is? Because it looks like we have some options.
Yeah, and see, I remember that quote, and I think it's fine. It's definitely relevant to point it out because, as we've touched on a lot of times on the show, it's clear that like he has an abundance of talent, and the question is, how do you get the most out of that? For my money, it's super evident that it's not at center back. Absolutely zero chance that it's that. Not only does that not utilize all his skill, but that's actually what I feel he's weakest at. That is where his faults are most under the microscope and most vulnerable and utilized against Minnesota United in that sense. So you can, center back is completely out of the question at this point for me, for him. Now, you bring up this quote that when we've talked about Calvo at center back, Calvo at left back, that discussion, when I think it was either you or other media had asked that question, you're right there, and he basically said, I want to play center back. We've got to check back with him on that because that just, to me, cannot even be accurate. Like, not even, or that can't
be. It doesn't make sense.
And he's not a bad English speaker, but it's definitely not his first language, and he's definitely not super articulate. And so I'm not saying he's, not smart or what have you. I just think maybe that was misinformed or he understood the question inaccurately. So I think that honestly is like one of the top questions. And honestly, we should get a running list. And that should be one of the top questions going into next season, right? When preseason starts and we're going to practices again and we're talking to guys, that should be one of the main questions we ask is of Francisco and of Heath. Of what do they think about his positioning and where does he want to be? Where do you want him to be? To Adrian and to Francisco. And I think that's another one that's especially poignant considering what he said after the game. Did you see his quote after the game?
I didn't.
So after the game, his quote on this, again, kind of runs contrary to that quote we had mid-season of him saying he wanted to stay at center back, which was someone asked him about obviously scoring the two goals in this game for United, and his quote was, I this is actually the lowest goal total I've had in a while. For me, I'm used to scoring about 5 goals a game, is what he said. So,
wait, 5 goals a game?
No, sorry, pause. sorry. I haven't had my full burrito yet. I'm a little spacey. 5 goals a season. And if that's coming from a guy who's expecting to score more, that tells me that that's someone that could be playing elsewhere.
Yeah, and it just like it's been so obvious since he's been playing at the outside back. I said in my recap of this game, he's been pretty close on scoring in several of the last games, whether it was an offside chance or a header coming up or runs that didn't get a pass, but that he was wide open for and making the smart continuing run after breaking out of the back. Like, the goals have been coming for him, but it's just like, how was this not unlocked earlier? And how, because I mean, we talked in March about where Calvo should be playing on the pitch. Like, it's not like we haven't known, and I'm sure Heath hasn't known, that he's got these skills and that he's got the raw skill that he has to be able to do these things. Like, where his first goal was a striker's finish. That was an extremely quality takedown on the chest, finish on the volley, placed it perfectly where the keeper couldn't reach it. That's a number nine. Like,
it was absolute quality. And even though the other one was kind of scrappy, like, it was still like a lot of, you could just tell there's a lot of great instinct there and a lot of great, again, as we've seen in different places, there's a lot of skill there. And there's been numerous times, you and I have been watching this team super closely all year, there's been numerous times we've been at TCF Bank Stadium watching him, and he'll make a play that is like exceptional and it just doesn't result in a goal, or it's a great pass but then United eventually lose possession. But he does things that very few guys on this team can do. I mean, heck, perfect example was, it was either one or two games ago back at TCF Bank Stadium. He scored a stunning goal, but he was just half a step offside. Like, this dude's talent. I mean, honestly, you could make a fairly legitimate argument that he should be playing at left wing going into next season. And I really don't think that's ridiculous.
Screw that. Play him at the nine.
So, yeah, I mean, something like... and again, I pointed out too, is like the contrast I want to provide is like, I for the most part feel like I try to defend Adrian. I try to calm the Heath out movement, because he does deserve time and deserve a full roster and all this, you know, set and ready to go before you can really fully judge him. But again, this to me is a bit of a black mark on him, because how you could see this guy every day in training, how you guys could go out and this be one of the first franchise signings, and you've to clearly kind of underutilize him or misplace him continuously for a year and a half and finally make that switch, that's concerning.
And with it's one of those things that, like, between Calvo's quotes and between Heath's usage of him and all of these points of data that we have in Calvo's relationship with Minnesota United at this point, it doesn't feel like this adds up. And like, there are decisions of Adrian's that, like, most of the time I can see his reasoning on why he does what he does. I may not agree with his reasoning, but I can understand it. This just, it feels like there might be something we don't know, or that there's something that doesn't, like, there's something doesn't make sense about this. And that's been abundantly clear for a long time now, but I don't know. I agree with you that it's one of, if not the biggest question for the players currently employed by Minnesota United going into 2019, is where Calvo will start for this team. He's the captain of the club. He's probably one of their five best players in terms of just raw skill. And how do you unlock him? So the point that you made earlier, I think, is a perfect point. And this game illustrates that. Like, we talked about a second goal. It wasn't the most skillful thing, but Poacher is the right. He looked like, pick any striker out of the league, the smarts to be where he was, the technique that he just placed it out of the goalkeeper's reach, didn't need to hit it too hard, sky it over the bar. He was just in the right place at the right time. And that's something you say of, like, you're like strikers all across the world. And for it to be a guy that you fielded most of the year at center back, it's just like, there has to be a better way to do this. Not least because you've got two good center backs on your squad employed already.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's the dynamic nature that he can provide is something this team desperately need. So the fact that you're sitting on that and you're not allowing it to flourish is really confounding. I'd say another thing about Calvo, and it's just something that's like, it's one of the soccer immeasurables, but it's something that I see as I watch games. There are guys that you can just sense their calmness when on the ball. And there's guys who just, they can be as good as they are. They're full on professional athlete, professional soccer player, and they just don't necessarily have that. And there's guys who, when they're on the ball, they just exude that confidence. It's really unseen, and you can't pick it up by how they always do things, but it just is there. And obviously Darwin is one of the guys on this team that has that, and Calvo's another one. Whenever he has the ball, it's not a panic. He's never in a panic. It's kind of something you have to really know the game and try to be able to sense, and it's in a huge quality. The players that have that are usually the game changers, and there's plenty of guys on United who don't have that. When they have the ball, it's a panic. What am I going to do with it? Where am I going to go? And in that type of play, that's when you have a lot of sporadic stuff and turnovers and bad decision making. And Calvo doesn't have. Calvo is so calm on the ball. I mean, again, I've made this argument before. Seeing again this from him, defensive mid or playing in the midfield, again, something he's done in the past also, by the way, could be a great fit for him. And, man, to me, what we've seen from Fernando, Bob, and I get what he seems to kind of like in Maximiano, but you put Fernando, Bob, and Calvo in a midfield, like, talk about a dynamic transfer, like, for this team. Like, that would be such a change and could have so many benefits. And, man, like, and that's what's so frustrating from, again, I can see where some people get frustrated with Heath is, this is a season where you could have tested all that, but now it's over. You had all these crap games, meaningless games, that you really were out of postseason play for a while, and you could have been trying different stuff, and you didn't. And now you're going to go into next year, and you've got to have a plan, and you can't be doing stuff willy-nilly. So, yeah, it's a little concerning.
That brings us really nicely to the point about the lineup in this game, which I mentioned, like, early in the afternoon on Sunday before the game started, that I didn't expect Adrian to make any changes. I hoped that he might give, you know, all of his rookies some time, his bench players some time, maybe try a new formation, anything. And he rolls out a starting lineup in which Colin Martin gets the start, which is awesome. But, like, it's the same 4-3-3 with the same parts that we've been seeing for weeks. Like, how are we not seeing minutes from like your Toys and your Manlys? How is it that, like, we saw Wyatt Omsberg in this game because Brent Coleman got hurt? We saw Abu Dunlady in this game because Angelo Rodriguez got hurt. Like, maybe we see those subs in the second half regardless, but it whether it's with the players or the formation or anything, it was running it out and doing the same thing we have done forever, and it didn't work again.
Yeah, I don't get that. I mean, the one argument is that Columbus did have something to play for, and so, you know, United owed it to Montreal, so to speak, to really give them their full test. But, you know, and I think that who cares? As I talked about in the last show, who gives a rip about Montreal and what have you? This is about Minnesota United, and this was a game you definitely could have put your young players on show and given them a chance, a platform to show you what they can do. And he didn't do it, and I don't get that.
Yeah, and and even within the structure of the game, Abu was once again pretty on the fringe for his entire time on the pitch, which he was on for stoppage time of the first half and the entire second half, and just kind of wasn't relevant again, like, which has been kind of what I've thought about Abu's play for a lot of this year, and same for Abu and Mason both. I felt similarly about their play, where, like, with Angelo, there can be complaints about his goal scoring. He is always involved in the development of Minnesota United's offense since he came to the club, through his play with his back to goal, through whether you agree with the long balls or not. There have been points that, like, Angelo is, I can almost always remember Angelo was involved in this. Angelo had a chance. Angelo made a run. Like, he had two pretty decent chances late in the first half before he came off. He was injured on the second one of those chances, had a collision with Zach Steffen, which, by the way, the MLS concussion protocol is a joke, and Steffen should have been off the field. Like, the broadcast showed him with a massive bump on his head, and that, it's one of those things that, like, you have to do better than that. But that's a side note. I can remember that. I don't remember what Abu brought to this game. And that's, like, whether that's through him, whether that's because the team's not setting him up, it's a question.
Well, I see. I felt like in his earlier appearances in the season, it was tough because it was so hit or miss or when he could be in the lineup or when he would feature.
Yeah.
But earlier in the season, I didn't feel that. But yeah, I agree. And you could, I mean, from a Heath perspective, that might be why Mason and Abu have found it hard to always get that regular playing time is that they don't understand those nuances. Angelo is, in a lot of ways, the antithesis of those guys. He's a veteran guy with a lot of experience. And so, obviously Heath was integral in bringing that guy in. So maybe that gives us a sign of what he really is lacking and frustrated with when it comes to Mason, and for in a different way, Abu as well. So, but he also said, it's also been clearly reported that Abu Dinlati was one of the main reasons Ramirez was traded. So, yeah, it'll be so fascinating to see how he plays it next season when he's got, again, more healthy bodies and, in theory, new players. Where does Abu fit into that? And is he a striker? Is he an outside mid? Does he come off the bench? Heath doesn't even like to use subs half the time, so would he, when would he play? I don't know. It's going to be really interesting.
Yeah, that's just – it's another one of those storylines is of the five players that the team added on draft day this past season between the – as a part of the trade, they got Matt Lampson. They got Mason Toy, Carter Manley, Wyatt Omsberg, and there was a fourth one, and I don't remember who it is. But we've seen moments from the three rookies, but with Heath's substitution policy, with his squad building, with his rotation, all three of the rookie players going into year two, is Carter Manley in consideration for the starting 11 for next season? Is Wyatt Omsberg a regular part of the rotation? What is Mason Toy's future with Angelo clearly going to be the starting striker going into next season and Abu being preferred ahead of him? I'm interested to see within the movements of the offseason, which we know that the club is going to be around in the transfer market and looking around and doing all these things that they always say they're going to do. Both Manny Lagos on the broadcast and Adrian Heath talked about adding players, as we've heard them so often do. There are going to be additions coming into the transfer market, but what do the pieces you already have that have had this year of bit part starts, occasional sub appearances, and time in the USL, what do those three players look like moving into next season?
I would say, from, do you think about, again, it's so hard with the ambiguity of who they'll bring in offseason acquisition wise, not to mention there'll be another draft as well. But with Romario Ibarra fully healthy, Angelo here now, Abu Dunlady's existence, it's hard not to picture. I would go to 80% chance Mason Toy's on loan next year, because I don't know why else he would be with the team. It's really hard to picture him being around. Manley is, I would like to see Manley get molded by a Tiaison or a Miller, and kind of he could stick around. But again, if we go into the next campaign with Miller and Tiaison as the right backs, let's just, for these purposes, Calvo's the left back, starting left back.
Yep.
They bring in, I think, and maybe we can talk about this on this pod, or we'll do it on the next week's episode. But I think it'll be obviously interesting to analyze who will be back and who won't be next year as a, the real large picture. But again, sorry, for these purposes, Mark Birch, I think, is out. And so it would be plausible that they'd bring in another left footer so that Tiaison doesn't have to go to that side. All my point being, that would be four outside backs, Manley being the fifth. And so it's probably a decent chance that he's loaned out as well. Wyatt probably the best chance of the three to stay. It'll be really interesting what they do with center back, though, because they've been pretty fortunate, to have minimal to zero injuries for Coleman and Boxall. And so you haven't seen, like, who – we don't even know – I mean, right now it seems like Wyatt would be number three. You never know. Heath might try to move Calvo back to the middle, of course. But, I mean, right? He never even plays Bertrand. And so, yeah, it's hard to get a feel on what they – how they rate Wyatt and the other center backs. So I'd say Wyatt right now, highest probability to stay. But, man, if again, from Heath's comments after yesterday's game, and again, as we know, one of the main weak points of this team is defense – I wouldn't be surprised if one of their moves actually is a bigger time center back, and then the utilizes Coleman or Boxall as depth, if that makes sense.
That would be an interesting move.
I wouldn't be surprised, dude. I would not be surprised.
Yeah, no, I feel you. My somewhat sentimental and somewhat realistic point in regards to center backs. I'm not thinking too far about off-season acquisitions, but give Brent Coleman a freaking raise.
Well, I wonder, though. I agree. I mean, dude, like,
if they don't do it, someone's going to.
Potentially.
I think he's an MLS starting center back.
Yeah, but I don't know that the uptick from an outside part. I mean, again, we know this because we watch him, you know, game in and game out. I don't know that, like, you know, Toronto FC's like, oh, we could grab Brent Coleman, the center back who's been on Minnesota United the last 2 years when they've allowed like 75 goals a season. Like, that's not going to look as sexy. We know
that's
that he's
fair.
Done. We know because we watch all the games that he's done pretty darn well, and it's not really his fault all the time. So, you know what I mean? So I think his value doesn't transcend to the whole league. And so my ultimate point being, he is such a great value that that's what they're going to want to keep him at. Like that, him having that low of a cap number could really help them, again, bring in more bodies. So I don't, unfortunately for him, again, my point being, I don't know that he has a ton of leverage.
So I'll put it this way, like, all of your points are fair. Brent Coleman of the... I'm looking at a graphic here and trying to do some math real quick. Of the 11, 22, 31 players currently on the books for Minnesota United, Brent Coleman makes the seventh least money of any player employed by the team.
Yeah, and he plays probably top 5 minutes. So,
yep.
Yeah. No, it's
there's just like there's something wrong with that. Like, you're not going to make him like a top five salary number in the squad. That's never going to happen. But kind of feels like he should be making six figures instead of five.
It does. It does. And I feel for him. I really do. But as I said, I don't know that he has the leverage. And so I don't
let me put it this way. Johan Venegas is receiving $238,000 from Minnesota United this year.
I know, but that's unfair. Of course, he's not playing for United. But also, I mean, technically he's not. I don't think he is because, yes, on the salary table he's getting that, but I think that's part of the loan deal is whoever has him is paying.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Not to mention.
It's one of those things that you look down this list of MLS salaries, which the union released this week, and it's about how you'd expect, and then you have to scroll all the way to the third column to find one of your starting center backs.
I know. But again,
just one of those things.
But again, to use your example, Johan Venegas is a guy that has played in the World Cup and regularly plays for his national team. So again, that's where Brent does not necessarily have leverage, where Johan does, and he's not that great of a player and hasn't been. So, but there's different context there.
Yeah, just different things. Yeah, I'll try and reshare this at some point tomorrow. It is at minimum interesting just to look at where United's salaries stack up in comparison to the rest of the league. They're a bottom, as you would expect, a bottom half of the league team in terms of total salary, and Toronto is like 2.5 times their total expenditure. But It's just one of those things that it's interesting to look at and see where stuff breaks down, because everything's about how you'd expect. And just in terms of pure salary value. By these figures, United have four players making over $500,000 in 2018, which is kind of like the benchmark, which is Darwin, Angelo, Romario, and Calvo. Those are the four. The next two guys are Ethan Finlay and Kevin Molino, which is functionally a change for next year and is another one of those things that, like, in these closing the book on this year and opening the book on next year, it's close to considering Finlay and Molino as new signings.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, quasi-new signings for sure. They barely featured this season.
Yeah, Molino was out in March for sure, and I think Finlay was first game of April or around there. Like, they neither of them played, like, at all this year. So that's one of those pieces, is because you expect that they're both going to be back, and how they fit into this attacking picture. It doesn't – assuming you trust one or both of those players as a fit in your attack, it doesn't feel like United need to sign another attacker, because you've got a lot of pieces to mess around with from the midfield up that are attacking minded MLS quality players from what we've seen in the past.
Yeah. I'm not sure that I'm picking up clearly on your point necessarily.
In terms of the signings, they don't need to sign more attackers this offseason.
Just knowing that we've known, right, this whole time, Molino and Finlay are coming back at some point. So that's where my head's been for a while, is not expecting any attacking, you know, added. Especially considering, again, one of the team's clear main issues is defensive frailty. So for me, the way I've looked at it lately is, or more recently, is that, again, center mid and defense are kind of the main transfer targets. That said, you can never, as much as they kind of do have some attacking depth once those two come back, you kind of can never have too many, you know, guys who can put it in the back of the net. So
you can upgrade for sure. I mean, it feels like they've got the bodies.
And, like, for example, you could easily say, like, Minnesota United in no way needs a number 10 because that's where their best player plays. However, what if the right opportunity came about that's what you could get, was a really good number 10? Then you could easily slot Darwin into an outside wing position where he would do super well, or as another striker or a lone striker, right? Darwin could do all those things, right? So it depends on what becomes available and what they can get. So one of my United sources told me pretty recently that the front office, specifically Lagos and maybe a couple other people, but Lagos was just in France actually scouting talent there in watching actually Ligue 1, so the top division in France, which is where, you know, that's about the level. If you can grab a guy from that type, that's kind of the level ahead actually of where they would have gotten Darwin, right, playing in Mexico's top division. If you can get a guy, yep, kind of a bench warmer but a good player from Ligue 1, that would be a great coup for Minnesota United. I mean, and there's a direct example like that, the MLS. That's where Alisson Drini of the LA Galaxy, one of the better DPs in the whole league, came from. So
yeah, and it doesn't feel like a player from Ligue 1 is likely to be out of the MLS's functional salary range, just because, like, when you look at most Premier League and Bundesliga and La Liga players, they're going to be making money that they just can't make in most teams, especially not in Minnesota. But it feels like, excluding Paris, Monaco, and maybe like your Marseille and Bordeaux, your like big city, big teams in France, you'll be able to compete financially with what you can offer. You can offer playing time. You can offer living in the United States, which could be good or not, depending on what you think. But, like, it feels like that's, you can offer something competitive to a player in that league, whereas you might have to offer more than that to a player from a higher league. So I agree. That feels like about the right level to be scouting. So good for Manny.
No, it's exciting potentially. I think that's where you would want him to be looking. So that's good. I mean, and I don't know exactly what it would be, but clearly coming here is somewhat alluring. I mean, Alessandrini came from Marseille, which is one of the top teams, you know, perennially in France. So, yeah, apparently there's something, you know, for them here, both financially and otherwise. So that's good.
I have a feeling being in LA helps, but
yeah,
I'm gonna say that, but you know,
yeah, it's true though. It's true.
Yeah, this game. Here's one. We're probably gonna go deeper into who's back and who's not. I feel bad. I am not sure Matt Lampson is back with this team next year. His mistake that allowed Columbus's second goal was not great, and it's not the first time that he's been directly at fault for a goal this season.
Yeah, he hasn't exactly covered himself in glory the whole time, but I don't know.
I loved what he did at the start of the season. You have to ask the question, not necessarily even because of him, but because you have your young goalkeeping prospect in Alex Kapp, who we didn't get to see at all this season. And if Kapp is ready to be the backup goalie full-time, maybe actually see minutes next year, that is the kind of thing that would make me wonder about Lampson's position with the squad and whether they sign someone like a tier even lower than him and let Kapp take the reins in the number two. That would be my question.
Yeah. Yeah, it's possible. I don't know. I think Lampson, on one hand, kind of completely serves what you would need and kind of want from a backup keeper. But, yeah, I mean, that would, if they let Lampson go, didn't bring anyone else in, and made Kapp the number two, that would tell you what they've seen from Kapp in training and what have you. But it seems
that Kapp's one of those dudes that, like, I've never, ever seen him play, but I keep hearing from people that like him. Like, so I'm intrigued by, Kapp is the mystery box goalkeeper to me, right? Like, he could be anything. He could be David De Gea, or he could be you playing goalie.
Yeah, I'm actually really bad at goalie. I'm really good at a lot of things, but playing goalie is not one of them.
So it's at least partially being enchanted by the mystery, since I don't have the scouting knowledge to know how good he is. But yeah, I'm curious. And given that we do now know, you were correct that Bobby Shuttleworth did miss these last few games due to rest or injury or what have you, having a number two that you will trust to start an MLS game is going to matter.
Yeah, especially because he missed the opening part of this season.
Yeah, he did. Lampson started the first four or five games of the year.
Yeah, because we found out something we didn't know, and that's that Shuttleworth has he has vertigo, which, again, is kind of a very ambiguous, you know, disease or whatever it is. And so one of the things that goes with vertigo is it can just kind of come and go. But when it comes, it can be, like, debilitating, and you can't do anything. And so it caused him to miss a good chunk of the beginning of the season. So, yeah, a backup goalie could be important.
Was he at all injured in a way that would suggest this could happen? That seems like such an odd ailment.
Well, he didn't leave a game. He was just out.
Yeah, he just couldn't start the season. Oh, like, it just came on in the preseason, and he couldn't go.
Sucks.
I when it happened, I really read up on it, and man, it's like, it sounds horrible.
Yeah, it just seems like something that would be, especially when I think of an athlete, would be as a result of an injury. But I'm not a doctor either.
Right.
Yeah, it's I was gonna say, I know nothing about, like, what happened, how it went, if even for sure that's what's happening now, because he missed, I think, the last four games of the season this year, which, like, veteran players do that in other leagues, so I didn't think that much of it. But if it is a reoccurrence of vertigo, that's something you've got to consider in roster construction for next season, because you've got to have somebody that's ready to go that will give up the quality.
Did you feel like watching this game, this is obviously a lot of people on people's minds, was kind of a question of effort being the last game of the season and, not having necessarily anything to play for. What did you feel like you saw effort-wise from this team?
Much better in the second half than the first half, I'll say that. The first half was really, really awful to watch for about half an hour, which was not helped by the conditions. Like I mentioned before, like I didn't see the first 10 minutes of this game. I imagine it wasn't great. They pull off the field for, I think, a total of 45 minutes and come back on in the 9th or 10th minute, technically. And United gives up a goal within 2 minutes. Bad marking by Michael Boxall. Same old, same old. Gyasi-Zardes is too good to leave open in the box on a cross. And just United, until about the 30-minute mark in the game, so 20 minutes after the restart, just could not string three passes together. Like, they were non-threatening. They played reasonably well on defense, but like they could not hold possession to save their lives. They really improved and set forward in the last 10 minutes, with Angelo in particular was at the core of their two best chances. But you think about effort and you think about the qualities that we've seen. It was another game that I had questions about how much Darwin Quintero cares about the end of the season.
Yeah. Yeah, and I don't. I've been saying this for a few weeks now. I don't know that the guys care a ton about these last few games.
Darwin is the one that pops out because he's so far. He's been so far below the level that we've seen. But like, yeah, he's the one that sticks out. But that might only be because of just the difference between his best level and this level, right? Like the other guys, maybe if they're down a gear, it's a lot less obvious. Maybe they don't get to a ball or two that they don't get to.
Yeah, and we're made aware of the MLS player salaries, but we don't know contract terms. But as I think I mentioned on previous episodes, I've been made aware that he's on a 3-year contract. So again, a guy who really doesn't have anything to play for in these last 5 games. So yeah.
Well, and to a degree, it's, I don't want to do my ACL in October after we're eliminated from the playoffs. Like, so maybe I'm not running all out. Maybe I'm not trying to take on 5 people like I usually do and probably shouldn't. Like, it was one of those things where, like, it was disappointing, but I get it. Like, there's a reason, like, in terms of goal scoring chances from United, the ones that stick in my head were Angelo and Calvo, which one of those things is kind of expected. One of them was a little weirder, but made sense at the time. And it's not like in their best points of the year, it's been Darwin at the core of every attack.
How long of a leash are you giving Heath next season? What are the parameters in your mind?
I put it this way. If the club starts badly, and this will at least partially be determined by their schedule, because I think from everything we know, Allianz Field is due to be completed on time and ready for the start of the MLS season next year. That said, we've seen before that the MLS scheduling can shift a little bit weirdly when new stadiums happen, with the more extreme cases happening when the stadium has to open later into the year, which we saw this season with both LAFC stadium and DC United's new stadium, which obviously DC's stadium opening had a huge impact on what the perception of their season will be, since they went from last in the East to finishing in 4th place in the East. Partially because they signed a really great designated player in Wayne Rooney, and partially because they had an enormously backloaded set of games at home because of how their stadium had worked. And we know from all MLS teams, but we know that how good Minnesota United was at home this season. If they start the season with, say, 4 out of 6 at home, win 3 of those 4 and get at least 1 point on the road, that's within range of what they've done this year and looks good. If they come out and can't get results at home, that is where I think questions might come quickly. I don't expect that the decision like if the pattern works like it did this year and the club can at least hold their ground at home, I think he's going to be okay probably into May or June. June is like, if I were picking a month, if I was expecting him to lose his job next season, I think I would put my money on June.
Because
it's enough into the season that if we see the same trends on the road that we've seen and the same trends in defense that we've seen, that's a big enough sample size that that changes could be made. And I would think it would be justified from a front office perspective.
Yeah. That might be kind of in line with my feeling, which is he should be given essentially half a season. Should be just blanket. You get at minimum. I mean, you can make it an easy argument, like might as well just give him the whole third season and then just go off of that, because then you'd have the whole offseason to bring in a new guy, et cetera. But I'd say generally, and especially because I know the fans are going to be on this if the team's at all struggling. So I would say you give him at least half a season, you know, just straight out the gate. And then the only thing you do is if they, you know, are really putrid in the beginning, right? 0-6, you know, 0-1-7 or something, lots of draws and lots of losses. And I think that you could fire him early. But separate from something like that happening, I think at minimum he should be given half the season.
I really do think it would take their home form going away for him to lose his job early in the season. Like, that was their calling card this year. That, in theory, like, you'd think that'll only get better with the new field and all the great fan support and all this like external stuff. Like, in theory, they should have a great home field advantage next year and continue to play well. If that changes, that's the red light for me that, like, Heath could go early.
Yeah, I mean, again, meeting, like, the way that this franchise has operated, like, I mean, even look what they've done with this, you know, gone on a clear 3-year plan, really bided their time, taken their time with everything that they've done. It's hard to see why they'd be quick trigger then, right? So I wouldn't be shocked even if they – it would not surprise me if they, even if they struggled still into next season, that they didn't give him, you know, close to the whole season, because you're gonna need that offseason really to bring in a new guy and have him really change things anyway. So,
well, and it's also like, who would they have in mind to bring in? Because it's, if you remove a coach, we see like at the highest level this with Real Madrid today. Firing Lopetegui, and I said that wrong probably.
I was like, as soon as you knew you were going to say his name, I was like, I'm interested to see how this goes.
If I said it wrong, I apologize. You can get me on Twitter after you listen. And wanting to bring in Antonio Conte, but having Conte reportedly change his mind and not commit to that, now having to go with, I believe, like their assistant manager currently, and just kind of being left without a tier one guy, which at a club like Real Madrid, currently sitting in ninth in La Liga, which is really, really bad for them. That's not a great look. And at a club of Minnesota's level, like, you want to know who your guy is before you're going to make a change in the best world, which kind of might be another reason to keep an eye on summertime, because summer's the middle of the MLS season, but obviously across the European leagues, that's the off season. And if you see a manager in Europe that's available and might be interested in coming to MLS, and United is struggling, looking about the same, still crap at defense, it looks like nothing has changed for year three in a row, then you might be at the point where you're making some phone calls and seeing if, hey, would you be willing to come to Minnesota? This is a thing. Like obviously Atlanta is the, like, top shelf example of everything you can try to do in MLS. Atlanta gets a former Barcelona manager and Tata Martino to come over and manage their team, and appears to have been a part of their success in addition to their large and smart spending. So it's, I don't know. I wouldn't, like, if I were betting generally, I wouldn't bet on him losing his job midseason. But if I were betting, if I knew he was going to lose his job before the end of the year next year, I would absolutely bet on Sommer.
Yeah, it makes sense. Did you know that Tata Martino is actually leaving?
I did.
How ironic, right? How ironic, again, in some ways, kind of the sister teams, United, Atlanta, and Minnesota, that, you know, one's had this crazy success and for sure is going to lose their manager. The other, stumbling the whole way, will have the same manager going in.
Well, and to be fair, it's not like Tata is, like, getting fired.
No, I know that.
Yeah.
It's still a funny
juxtaposition. It does look ironic, yeah.
Yeah, so that's...
So, yeah, and that's... That is a point that might shift us onto a little look at the MLS playoffs before we're done for the day, unless you've got anything particularly pressing you wanted to hit with United.
Nope.
I did have one more thing I wanted to hit with United, which is I opened the show with another record-breaking season. Nick Hallett, did you hear the record that was broken yesterday?
I don't know necessarily which one you're touching on.
Minnesota United broke their franchise record for most goals allowed in a season in yesterday's game.
Yep, that's cool.
Which, as you might know, set the MLS record in 2017 with 70 goals allowed. Columbus's final goal yesterday was the 71st goal allowed this season by Minnesota United, which did not break the MLS record thanks to Orlando City, but not a great look for a club that has preached improvement for the year to finish at the same point total with more goals allowed. And I think just two, I think they slightly better in goal difference and slightly better in goals scored, thanks to the captain himself, Francisco Calvo. Just, it's one of those things that, like, you take a step back and just look at the season numbers, it's like, those don't look different at all.
I hear you, and a lot of people have pointed to all these things on Twitter and otherwise to be like, yeah, Minnesota United totally, like, on the up and up, totally improving, nice one. But I guess here, let's flip that a little bit and look at it like this. They did, that first season happened all without Darwin Quintero. And we know, scientifically, as a fact, he is exceptional and a very, very good player. And now he's on the team. So what does that tell you? That tells you that in the first season without him, they were able to still do what they did with, you know, sans Darwin. And now they have that guy. And again, one of the main reasons, you know, the main guys in that first season that allowed them to have any of the wins that they had or any of the success that they had was Kevin Molino. And so now you come to this next season, you know, the third season, you'll have both those guys now in the team. And so that, to me, I think if you look at it through that lens, it says that you know for a fact they're going to improve. You know almost like certifiably that they will improve because Darwin is too good, right? If you do all that equation, without Darwin, they were that's how they finished, and with Darwin, that's how they finished. Something was missing, and it points, I guess it kind of really points to Molino's value, and it tells you that there's an equation where it's hard to not see them improve in year three. So there's the positive spin on that.
Yep, which we flipped roles. Good job.
Yeah, yeah. I'm versatile.
Yeah, we made it work. So if we take a look at the final MLS playoff standings, the most notable thing, We spoke last week having seen LA Galaxy and seeing Real Salt Lake have the result that would have let LA, I believe, get into the playoffs with a draw or a win against the Houston Dynamo, who were below them in the standings, a very winnable game. LA Galaxy get a 2-0 lead, give up three straight goals to the Dynamo, and crash out of the MLS playoffs. So the team that signed Zlatan Ibrahimovic, which we saw at TCF Bank Stadium last weekend, will not appear in the MLS playoffs, which I think is a little bit of a shock.
It's pretty, yeah, it is. It is crazy, especially, you know, if you have in this type of league in the MLS to have that good of a player and that not be enough. Man, you could argue that the Galaxy are really bad. But there's two other main thoughts on that is like, that could be the last we see of Zlatan in MLS.
It very well could be.
There is a very decent chance that that's the last we see of him now. Also, did you see Chris Wondolowski's quote when Zlatan first got signed by LA Galaxy?
I hope they finished seventh.
Yeah, and then they did. That's so awesome.
Oh, Wando, always able to finish his chances, except when they count the most. And then everyone was sad. So the complete picture of, in the West, Sporting Kansas City finished with the top seed in the conference, followed by Seattle, LAFC, FC Dallas, Portland, and Salt Lake. Nick Hallett, right now, off the top of your head, who wins the West?
Give me my options again.
Kansas City, Seattle, LAFC, Dallas, Portland, Salt Lake.
LAFC. They look
all right.
They look when they're awesome, they're really awesome. Sporting KC though would be my B choice.
I was going to say I think I'm going to go chalk and take SKC. Like it doesn't help that I watched them just blast United once this season at Sporting Park, and the fact that they have a say in having all the games go through Kansas City and have home games for a lot of that. Chuck, I have trouble seeing them dropping enough to lose before the MLS Cup final. The Eastern Conference, we have the other upset of the day. Atlanta managed to lose to Chicago, and New York Red Bulls went out and got their win. So New York Red Bulls win the Supporters Shield over Atlanta United.
Yeah, that's surprising.
Surprising, but good for New York. They also had a great season, and Atlanta's gotten a lot of the headlines, but New York finished with the total over 70 points. So the complete picture in the East, New York Red Bulls finished with the top seed, followed by Atlanta, New York City FC, DC United in fourth, Columbus in fifth, and Philadelphia in sixth. Nick Hallett, who comes out of the East?
Still rolling with Atlanta. Still rolling with them. Like I said before, I really think they have a bone to pick based on how last season ended. And they're going to be especially motivated, again, due to something we referenced earlier on today's show. This is their manager's last run.
Yep, and it's interesting because they didn't finish the regular season that well. So I hope they can turn it around in the playoffs, and you'd expect they've got the emotional motivation. They've got home games to come. Like, you'd expect that they're probably going to be okay. I am also sticking with what I said last week. I will take DC United to go to the MLS Cup.
Yeah, and that'll be fun, and it's very possible.
They are the form team in the entire league. They're the hottest team around. They've got they've got Rooney, who's been a revelation. So I'm sticking with what I said last week, and I will take DC United. They're the hottest team in the league. They get their opening round game against Columbus at home at Audi Field, which has been so huge for them this season. Finished 13-2-2 at home this year, which is just unreal.
Wow.
And I just I'm going to trust the hot team at the right time. It's the team that got hot going into the playoffs. I think they can pull off an upset and really make an impact this year. And in fact, I would, if my pick is DC and Sporting Kansas City and MLS Cup, I would take DC to win the whole thing.
Yeah, I think that's a fair call. I think it would be most fun to see like a setup where DC, going against Atlanta in a conference final and seeing an LA FC going against KC in a final. So
that'd be a lot of fun.
Yeah, it'd be a lot of fun.
So that's pretty much the MLS. We touched a little bit incidentally on a little bit of global football with the news about Real Madrid firing their manager after getting their butts whooped in the Clasico this weekend, 5-1 by Barcelona.
Yeah, I mean, and as you said earlier, Madrid in ninth, that just doesn't even
it's just
brain,
wrong.
My brain doesn't even want to let me say that out loud because it doesn't make any sense. It's crazy. I mean, but again, you sell the arguably the best player in the world, and then not only do you do that, you don't replace him with anyone. And then you go and play your games, and now you're the worst you've been in a long time. Oh, that's bizarre. How did that happen?
So yeah, it looks like you get rid of one of the two greatest goal scorers of the last 20 years and expect you won't have problems scoring goals.
Yeah, it's interesting. Peculiar. I mean, I liked the idea because I think it was cool. The concept of giving Marco Asensio and Isco more prominent roles would have been really fun and could have worked in theory, but yeah, it's tough. I don't watch La Liga super closely, so I haven't watched their games, and so I don't know what's really going wrong. But
you see the results, and it's just like something's got to be weird.
Yeah, something's up. How about lastly, let's end on this. Your squad, Tottenham Hotspur, taking on Man City today, falling short 1-0. What's going on with that team?
I was at work for this game.
Well,
you
didn't get to see it, is what you're saying.
I have not seen the game. No.
Okay, so but my main question actually doesn't necessarily dictate that you watch the game. Why are Heung-min Son and Dele Alli and Christian Eriksen not featuring? Like they're starting. They were all three available, but they all were on the bench. And they didn't even feature till very late. Eriksen came on with like 8 minutes left. Dele Alli came in with like 14 minutes left. What is that?
You wonder a little bit if it's because so they don't start. And I wonder a little bit if it's Poch just kind of seeding that they're likely to lose this game and they'd rather get the week of rest for those players and just go in and clean up the rest of their games rather than trying to mess with
that
City.
Can't be it though, dude. That can't be. This was at home at Wembley. Had they won, they would have leapfrogged City in the table. And this game, as someone who watched it, and just so you know, it was a game that it was 1-0 early City, but then the rest of the game was tight, and it only became clearer and clearer that this was a game that Tottenham could get points from. And so I get, even if Poch went in with that idea in the beginning, it doesn't make sense not at the 60th minute not to bring on Eriksen and Dele and Son at that point then. Because the game was very much in the balance.
Interesting.
Yeah, I didn't get it.
I haven't seen or like had anything to do with this game, so I'm not in a great place to speak on what happened or anything. But it's interesting. You said you watched the game. How bad did the field look?
It was bad. It was so bizarre just looking at it, you know, it just because it had all the lines on it still.
Yeah.
It had like the NFL logo in the center still. So it was, yeah. And there was tons of dirt spots. It was bad.
Yeah. It's for clarity, if you didn't, weren't aware of this, the Jaguars and somebody else played yesterday.
The Eagles.
I forget who do you remember, Tom, do you remember this, who the two teams who played in London were?
The Eagles.
Jaguars, Eagles. So the Jaguars and Eagles played an NFL game at Wembley on Sunday. And then Tottenham had to play at Wembley on Monday against Man City on the same field, on the same pitch. So all of they did what they could to get rid of the lines and stuff, but most of the lines were still pretty clearly visible on the pitch. The field was in the shape of it had an NFL game played on yesterday. So that's not great.
that weirdly happened, little different circumstance, but with USC and the Rams.
Yeah. So did you ever hear an explanation?
You can't get the paint out sometimes.
Here was my theory. Why wouldn't you spray paint green over it then? And then spray paint over with the logo you wanted.
I don't know. I also think that's artificial turf, and I feel like you should be able to get it out of there. But it's funnier when it's a football field, like grafted into a soccer. It's a little like with the Raiders, where you're like, oh yeah, that's right, this is a baseball stadium too.
Right.
But yeah, no, I think that's a funnier situation with the Wembley deal.
Hey Nick, could you do me a favor and look up who was the teams that played at Wembley for the NFL?
No.
Which teams were it again?
David, I don't know if you heard me. I told you the Eagles like three times.
Did I miss it?
Three times.
All right, cool. Nope. That's a sign. We need to be done.
The best part was I was saying Eagles every time you asked, but then you were like, Tom, do you know?
Once you hear it from me, it's official.
No, I trust Tom to bring me the facts. That's I don't know what else to say. Like,
I'm with you.
He really is
I'm
a trustworthy guy.
This is a half burrito man right here. Full burrito, he knows the stuff.
Yeah, keep in mind I'm at half burrito.
Speaking of facts and quality, Tom Schreier, what quality stuff do we have on zonecoverage.com right now?
Plenty of quality stuff. If you want that recap from that game, David Naylor, phenomenal. He went out strong. Team may not have. David Naylor went out strong. Twins offseason blueprint from Brandon Warren. Lots of Saints Vikings stuff from Sam Ekstrom. We will have some stuff on the LeBron versus Jimmy Butler Lakers Wolves game.
Who won?
That was the Jimmy Butlers, the Wolves in there.
The flying Jimmy Butlers got the W.
Butler, for those who don't know, balled out in that game. But yeah, no, a lot of stuff from around the Twin Cities. Definitely check it out. Subscribe, toss us a little cash.
Instant yes, no to Tom and to David. Would you take the Houston Rockets deal for Jimmy Butler? Yes or no?
Listen to the Dane Moore podcast. He will explain how the protections work.
He used it as a promo.
if the protections are good, you obviously do it. But I don't think it's four first round picks if you actually look to do it.
Okay, that's actually a legit promo though, because Dane does fantastic work on that podcast.
Yeah, and that was exactly what I was going to say. Is the protections are the key with that, and I'm sure Dane covered that in great detail.
It's a yes no though, and you guys violated.
Listen,
Come on.
Nick Hallett comes on here, spews just nonsense, non facts. Doesn't even need his whole burrito.
This is sounding like a political
debate. Did you just call Nick Hallett fake news?
Yeah. Whoa.
This, I'm offended on Nick's behalf. That's rude.
I'm offended myself.
Before this gets any worse, let's get out of here. So we will continue to bring you the Minnesota Soccer Podcast through Minnesota United's offseason. I think next week we're going to tackle who's going to be here and who's not of the current team, and figure out all kinds of stuff to cover between the MLS playoffs and the European leagues and all that stuff. So we will have weekly podcasts for you all the way through the MLS playoffs and offseason. So join us for that. I am David Naylor. You can find me on Twitter at Prof Cedar. Nick Hallett at Prince Hallett. Tom Schreier at TSchreier3. This has been the Minnesota Soccer Podcast, part of the Zone Coverage Podcast Network. We will see you next week.